Go ahead and get started. Thank you for being here. I had to run from the parking lot, so if you hear some heavy breathing, it's me. It's more than about 10 steps, I'm in trouble. But I do want to thank you for being here. We're still in transition. We're just going to watch things in the next couple weeks as we begin to move forward through the state and through just our local community. You do know we have Harvest Monday supposed to start next month, July the 13th, I believe. So we'll just play that by ear. As far as right now, it's still a go. We may have to modify some things to make it work. As of right now, we're still on schedule. There has been a request from Joyce Davis that we remember her family. When we pray, so y'all remember them. We've had quite a few deaths of members and family members, so remember them as well. There's a lot of that going on around us. This virus is still there. Treat it and respect it. That's why we have the chairs such as we do, to keep you separated. We do want families to sit with families, of course, but if you can keep your separation, please do that. Anything else going on we need to know about? There is no Sunday school right now. Vacation Bible School is still just kind of playing with that, seeing how things go. It was actually supposed to be this week, I believe, but it's been postponed for a while, so we'll let you know as things progress on that. Anything else? Remember our offering, things are at the doors, front door and back door, or you can do it through our online app. If you've got that, if you don't have it, let me know and we'll get you set up. All right, nothing else. We're going to let men and ladies sing. Y'all just stand and join us. Thank you for being here.
I believe.
I've learned, and I'm sure all of you that have that are older than me, you've learned that this world is full of chaos and brokenness. And the way I look at it, I'm not trying to give you no hope this morning. That's never going to end until Christ comes back. And my desire, y'all just listen to my heart this morning before I get into the sermon. The question I have, why can't God's people get their eyes on the greatness and on the grace of Christ? Ask yourself that, because as I look around this room, I'm assuming you're in Christ, you've given Christ your life, because this is the church. Why can't God's people, including myself, get our minds and our hearts on the greatness and on the grace of Christ? Yeah. Yeah. Amen? And I'll just say this, if our eyes are on the greatness and on the grace of Christ, our hearts won't be so full of hate. Our hearts won't be so full of division. Our hearts won't be so full of gossip if we truly get our hearts on the grace and on the greatness of Christ. Our church would be filled with the power of God if we would just get our eyes back on Christ. You know how I know? Because I read the book of Acts. And no matter of the chaos, they have their eyes on the grace and on the greatness of Christ. Amen. And my heart longs to see that. And here's my prayer. I know it's a dangerous prayer, but here's my prayer. God, get anyone out of peace that don't want to get their eyes on the grace and on the greatness of Christ that will hinder the mission of God at peace. Amen. Paul said the same thing. Anyone that's going to hinder God's mission, Lord, save them, help them to repent, or just get them out. So that we can march forward with the gospel. So that the power of God can be unleashed. Amen? And I say that with all love. Right? I mean, maybe for me, my salvation is recent. Christ saved me 8 years ago. And I can't figure this out, church. Why do we get our eyes off Christ? Didn't he save you? Hasn't he dropped down upon your life, or have you forgotten how good his grace and greatness is? Because I know where I was at. Amen. Dead in my trespasses, no relationship with King Jesus, and he decided on September 2012 to drop down and redeem this boy. And I come into the church, every church I've been at, man, it's like we just get our eyes off this grace and this greatness. And it hinders the mission of God. And I'll just say this, if you're full of hate this morning, you need to repent. If you're full of bitterness this morning, you need to repent and get your eyes back on the grace and on the greatness of God. And you say, well, Pastor Steve, why do you say that? Because John tells you that in the book of Revelation. Amen. Amen? The world is dying, going to hell, and the people of God are full of fighting and fussing and bitterness and complaining and grumbling, and people need to get saved. Church, when are we going to repent? When are we going to repent? In other words, when are we going to turn our minds back to King Jesus and say, we're going to do it your way? Amen? And we do this because he's great. We do this because he's full of grace. Word?
Word.
Hey, turn your books, Bibles, to the book of Revelation, chapter 1. Chapter 1. I'm going to read the last part of verse 5, where it says, to him who loved us, in verse 6 through 8. When you're there, say,
word.
And everybody can just relax. Amen. My heart's just heavy because I know there's people that are dying and going to hell right now, and God's called the people of God to stand up. Amen. Isn't your heart heavy for lost people? It should be if you're a Christian, by the way. Don't you remember the grace and the greatness of Christ whenever he first saved you?
Amen?
And that's why when we get to Revelation chapter 2, we're going to see, he says, return back to your first love, because we've forgotten how much God loves us. And we've gotten so distracted from what really matters in the local church. But real quick, let's talk about this grace and greatness this morning. To him who loved us. You see where I'm at, verse 5, the end of it. To him who loved us. Everybody say loved.
Loved.
You know Christ loves you, don't you?
Amen.
He laid down his life for you. Amen. You don't deserve his love. He just freely gives it to you. Amen. Amen. You're a sinner, dead in your trespasses, and he came and what? Loved you. Amen. While you were a non-believer, he came and chased after you. Don't you remember the gospel? That's the gospel, church. Dirty, rotten sinners. And Christ comes and pours out his love to you and me. Keep on reading. And he washed us. Aren't you glad he washed you? He has this idea you were in chains. And you couldn't get out. And he came and he released you. It has another idea that, guess what? Your life was stained with sins. And he came and washed you up. Aren't you glad of that, church?
Yes.
You were locked up, no relationship with Christ, and he came to release you from our sins in his own blood. In other words, you can't save yourself. It's his blood that saves you.
Amen.
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 Keep on reading. He has made us kings and priests to his God and Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, everybody say behold. It's mentioned about 25 times in the book of Revelation. He is coming with the clouds. Every eye will see him, even the people you don't like that are in Christ. Amen. Keep on reading. Even they who pierced him. And all the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him. Even so, amen. Not just white people. Amen.
Amen.
Black people, Hispanics. Amen. People overseas in the Middle East, Muslims that have given their life to Christ, they will see him. Everybody will see him when he comes back. Those that think differently than you will see him.
Amen.
Those that think like you will see him. Those that are in Christ will see him. And those we're going to see outside of Christ will see him. Amen. He's this great. Listen to what he says in verse 8. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, says the Lord. That's what the Lord tells you.
Amen.
He's in control of all of history, not you and me.
Amen.
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 We're going to look at that. Who he is and who was and who is to come. The all what?
Almighty.
Church, let's go to prayer and ask God to open up our hearts. Father, help us to see how great you are. Help us to see, Father, how loving you are. And you've called us to be your leaders in this world. You've called us to get our minds on your greatness and on your grace. Father, please help us to do this. God, please give me the words to speak. In Christ's name, amen. How many of you know that along the journey, chaos will happen, suffering will happen. People you disagree, you will have those encounters. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Life will happen, right? And I've noticed in my 8-year journey, maybe this will help you out, what happens when life happens, we get our minds off God's grace and off of God's greatness.
Right.
Amen. Because listen to this, his grace and his greatness will never change. And what happens so often, life happens and we get our minds off Christ. And so if you're in this room this morning and you're drained to your core spiritually, it might be because you've gotten your eyes off Christ. Amen. If you're drained spiritually this morning, meaning if there's no inward satisfaction with your relationship with Christ, it might be a good chance that you have gotten your eyes off Christ.
Amen.
Right? Because we're going to see next week, I got a message for my senior adults, right? I'm going to encourage you that God's not done with you yet.
Amen?
Just think about John. He's in his latter days, and God comes and reveals himself to John and says, go equip the church in his senior adult days. Amen? So just imagine John is in his latter years. He is struggling physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually, and God comes to John and says to John, I'm with you, son. Amen? Because life happens, right? We know that Nero is slaughtering Christians, right? He is beheading Christians. Christians are being fed to lions, right? In other words, politically, spiritually, physically, John's life is wore out.
Christ, aren't you glad in wherever we're at, he comes to us.
Amen.
And he says, get your eyes back on me. Because a lot of you in this room and watching right now, you're wore out. And you need to get your eyes back on Christ. Anybody testify, or y'all just, y'all got it all together this morning? A few of you. So listen to this. Two dominant things you see in Revelation is this. Christ's greatness. Everybody say greatness.
Greatness.
And grace. Everybody say grace.
Grace.
These are two things that all Christians in this room, you need to meditate on, you need to grow in, and you have to continually point your mind back to what? God's what? Greatness and God's what?
Grace.
Grace. Because I guarantee you, if you walk with Christ long enough, life is going to happen. And you need to be reminded of his grace and his greatness, just like John and just like all of us in this room. So, the grace of Christ. Look at the end of verse 5. To him. Everybody say to him.
Amen.
Talking about Christ, who loved us and what?
Washed
us from our sins in his own blood. So, the first thing is he loves you.
Amen.
You wore out, church? Christ loves you. You know how I know? Look at the cross. Amen?
Amen?
He poured out his life for you.
Amen.
He bled for you. For all of your dirty, rotten sins, all of your bitterness, all of your grumbling, all of your complaining, all of your sexual immorality, whatever your sin is, Christ loved you so much that he laid down his life for you.
Amen.
Word. Before you came to him, let me just remind you of that. Before you came to Christ, he lovingly laid down his life for you because he loves you deeply. What's the second thing he done for you there? He washed you. Everybody say washed.
Washed.
So listen to this. It has this idea that we were filled with sins and Christ removed them. Amen?
Amen.
Just think about that. You were filled with sins, still are, but Christ washed you. So I think you need to ask yourself, what does that mean? Right? It has this idea that you were locked up in sin and Christ is the only one that can come and release you. Praise God. Amen?
Amen?
Danny Aiken writes this. He's the president of the seminary in Wake Forest. He freed us from sin's penalty, our justification. Everybody say justification.
Yes.
This has the idea right now, if you've given your life to Jesus, you're no longer guilty for your sins in the mind of God.
Amen?
Amen? We were once, what, guilty. When God looks at you, he says, what, not guilty.
Amen.
Get that in your mind right now. That's grace, church. You don't deserve this.
Amen.
Right? When you place your faith in Christ, he says, not guilty.
Amen.
This should cause us to worship this morning. This should cause us, we're going to see, to be on mission this morning, that you're no longer guilty before God. And so the question is, well, can we just live the way we want to live? Absolutely not. Amen?
Amen.
Two, he is freeing us, Danny Aiken says, from the sin's power, which you've heard it, our what? Sanctification. This has the idea that sin no longer has to dominate your life. Just imagine that. Amen?
Amen.
You no longer have to be dominated by your sinful self. Christ gives you the power to live for him. Amen. Right? Justified. No longer guilty. Not a license to live the way you want to live, but it is a license to live in the power of God.
Amen.
Praise God. And so listen, third. Everybody say third.
Third.
It has this idea that he will free us from sin's presence. It has the idea of our glorification. Amen? It has this idea that in heaven, you and I will no longer have to deal with our sinful, dirty self. And the sinful nature of others.
Amen.
Amen. Word? So right now, you're justified, no longer guilty before God. He has washed you. He has loved you. Amen? Now and forever, guiltless in God's sight. That's freedom, church. Freedom to be sanctified. Freedom to live in his power as he cleans you up. Amen? No Christian should say, the devil made me do it. The Holy Spirit is living in the people of God to wash us and to clean us so that we can live for his glory. Amen? We just have to press into this power, church. You got it. The Holy Spirit, Paul tells you in Ephesians, has sealed you. We can live for him now. And aren't you glad glorification is on its way for all of us in this room? Amen? Sin will no longer be present when we are in heaven with the Lord. So listen to this. The grace calls us to be kings and priests. Look at verse 6. And has made us kings and what? Priests to his God and Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. So what does that mean? It has this idea that you are called to lead in this life. Everybody say lead.
Lead.
All of God's children, listen to this, should be leading in this world. Amen? We should be leading, listen to this, in our culture and in our communities. We should be leading in this nation and to the nations. Amen? We should be a voice for those babies that are being slaughtered every single day. Amen. This evil we call abortion. Amen? We should be kings and priests. We should be leading on the front lines. Amen? We should be leading when in the context of orphans. Amen? Amen?
Amen.
Adoption, in other words. Amen? James tells you to take care of the widows and who? Orphans. Right? We should be leading in adoption in the churches. Amen?
Amen?
We are called to be kings and priests, leaders in our community. We are called to fight against any evil act within the community and the world. Are y'all awake this morning?
Amen.
That is rooted, go read Genesis chapters 1 and 2 tonight. That is rooted in those two chapters that God created us in his likeness and in his image to be leaders in this world. And we do that because we're rooted in his love and in his washing. Amen. Didn't he wash you? Hasn't he cleaned you? Aren't you guiltless right now in his sight? Therefore, lead for his glory. Amen? And here's the one I'm going to cut probably 10%, maybe 20% of you off. He's called us to be a voice against racism.
Amen.
Amen? And I'll just say this. I've encountered white racist people. I've encountered black racist people. I've encountered Hispanic racist people. We're called to fight against all racism. Because all humans are made in God's image. You know how I know? Genesis chapters 1 and 2. You know how I know? He's about to tell you that all people will see his coming. All people. Brothers and sisters, it's time for the church to be a voice in the community and in the culture. It's time for us to quit hiding in our comfortable positions and get out and fight for all justice. That's what he tells you. You're kings and priests. You're called to be leaders. Don't argue with us, God. I'm thankful that Christ fought for the Samaritan woman, aren't you? Y'all remember that story, don't you? The Jewish people didn't want to deal with her because they thought they were supreme. Y'all remember the story? He says, woman, I'll give you eternal life. Even though the Jewish people neglect you, I love you. Amen. He didn't go with the status quo. He broke down the strongholds. He gave us an example to lead for his glory. It's time that we start that, church. Amen?
Amen.
Everybody say kings.
Kings.
Everybody say priests.
Priests.
We are called to lead, church. Y'all listen to this, because I know I've heard this. I've even made this excuse. You know what? I didn't cause the problem. Therefore, it's not my responsibility. Anybody ever say that? So y'all listen to this. Y'all stay tuned. Sin is not Christ's problem. It's our problem. But he came and made it his responsibility by laying down his life and dying for our sins. It might not be your problem, whatever the problems are in culture, but it is as your role as a Christian, as a king or a priest of Christ, to make it your responsibility. Amen. I'm glad Christ didn't make excuses. Well, it's not my problem. You know, you're a sinner. You just want to die and go to hell. He laid down his life. You want to reflect the image of God? Go and make it your responsibility, even though you didn't cause the problem. Amen. Aren't you glad that's what Christ did for you? Amen. I mean, I'm thankful.
brothers that took up for me and blamed him growing when there were some racist people. Well, he's just a little white boy. They said, no, man, like, he's coming to ball with us. Accept him. Amen? I've seen black brothers and sisters fight for justice in the community. And we must fight it, church. It's our responsibility, even though maybe we didn't cause the problem. You really want to follow Christ, church? It's going to cause us to have to do some tough ministry, but it'll be for his glory. Amen? Why y'all so quiet? Everybody say word.
Word.
Aren't you glad that's what Christ did for you? Everybody say sinner.
Sinner.
You are a sinner. And he came and made it his responsibility by suffering on the cross for you and me. Be kings and priests, church. It's a call to obedience. Amen? You remember the disciples, we don't got the food to feed them. Did Christ say, oh, not my problem, they should be working. Said, no, I'll feed them. I mean, just go read the Bible, church. It's all throughout the Gospels. But anyway, let's move forward. Everybody say, the greatness of Christ.
The greatness of Christ.
All right, so let's look at this. Look at verse 7 with me. Behold, everybody say, behold.
Behold.
I think I mentioned this word in our leadership series a few months ago. It's mentioned about 25 times in Revelation. So that's something we should probably pay attention to. It's a call to pay attention. Imagine that. Everybody say, pay attention.
Pay attention.
Did you know humans have had the problem, including Pastor Stephen, of paying attention ever since Genesis chapters 1 and 2? Amen? The wilderness happened because the people of God just wouldn't pay attention. Like, God just saved them from the most dominant and powerful nation on the planet, and they just couldn't pay attention. Amen? The disciples, man, they just couldn't pay attention. And we today, we just can't pay attention. Amen? And aren't you glad that the gentle voice of God comes to you and says, behold.
Amen.
Amen. Everybody say, behold.
Behold.
Pay attention, because the word of Christ, they are perfect.
Amen.
Amen. Like, we should obviously pay attention to each other out of respect when we're talking, but y'all listen to this. Shouldn't we show Christ's respect because his words are perfect? Amen. And so y'all listen to this. We are called to pay attention to his words because he is perfect and he is coming really soon for his people. So y'all look at verse 7. Behold, he is coming with what? Clouds. And just some eyes will see him. Just the eyes of the Republicans will see him, or Democrats will see him. Who's it say? Oh, just the white church? Just the black church? Just the Hispanic church? Says who? Says all people. All people made in the image of Christ. Keep on reading. Even those who what pierced him, those that are against him. Amen. And the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him. So y'all listen to this. I put two verses in your notes. Exodus chapter 13, verse 21, if you're taking notes right now. I'm not going to turn there. In Exodus chapter 16, verse 10. The clouds in the Old Testament were a symbol of the presence of God. Listen to this. When Christ comes back, all ethnic groups and nations will be aware. Just think about that, church. When Christ comes back, everybody's going to be aware that's made in his image. All humans, saved and unsaved, will be aware of his second coming. Nobody will be able to escape the presence of Yahweh when he comes back and shows his glory to the whole world. Amen. And so, interesting here, you see where it says the earth will mourn because of him. Some will mourn his coming, not in a positive way. Just think about that. Some will continue to reject him. Imagine that. Like, he's showing himself to the whole world and they're going to continue to reject him. It reveals that the heart is deceitful.
The heart is wicked, and even when Christ comes back and his presence is revealed to the whole world, people will continue to reject him. Go to chapter 6 real quick. Let me just show you. Chapter 6, starting at verse 15 of Revelation. Chapter 6, verse 15. Listen to this. You talk about the wickedness of the human heart. And the kings of the earth. Y'all see it? The great men, the rich men, the commanders, the mighty men, every slave and every free man hid themselves in the caves and the rocks of the mountains and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. And you say, what's the point? Hey, listen, brothers and sisters, here's the point. Y'all ready for this? This is really helping me out. Not everybody is ready for the presence of the Lord, even when he makes that presence fully known to humanity. Right. You say, what's the point? Don't you want people to see the presence of God? Because they need to see the presence of God right now. If he's your Savior and he's living with you, he shows you his presence. You know what helps me as a pastor, Stephen? Not everybody's ready for his presence. And even when he comes back, they're going to be running away from his presence, trying to kill themselves. Reject his loving presence now and when he comes back and reveals himself globally. So you say, what's the point? Don't let man determine your worship this morning. Let me say that again. Don't let man determine how you worship King Jesus this morning. Because what's happened to me ever since I've been saved for 8 years, I let man determine how I worship Jesus. Listen, I worship Jesus because he's great and he is great alone. Christ doesn't have to strive for greatness. He just is great. And when he comes back, the global world will see his greatness. That causes me to worship him, not how people respond to the gospel. Amen? Not how people worship Jesus. I worship Jesus because he's just great alone. People will reject him now and even when he comes back. Don't let man's rejection of the gospel determine how you worship the Christ of the gospel church. Too many of you are drained because you let man determine how you worship. You worship Christ simply because of who he is. Can I get a word?
Word.
Some of you are drained because of man's response to the gospel. John says, you know, man will always reject the good news, even when he comes back in his full glory. So worship, child of God. Don't let man get you distracted. Amen?
Amen.
Keep on reading. Everybody go to verse 8. Everybody say verse 8. I am the Alpha and the Omega. Let that sink in, church. You talk about Christ's greatness right here. I am the who? Alpha, and I am the who?
Omega.
Omega, the beginning. Everybody say beginning.
Amen.
Everybody say, and the end.
Amen.
Says the who?
The
Lord. Let it sink in. He is the Alpha, he is the Omega, he is the beginning, and he is the end. Not you and me. You say, what does that mean? Well, Alpha is the first letter in the Greek alphabet, and Omega is the last letter. Christ is proclaiming that all of history is within his power. Amen? Past, present, and future history is all in the hands of Christ, not you and not Peace Baptist Church. Amen? Christ existed before this church. He existed before you and me. That's the gospel. And that should make Christians mad. That should cause us to worship. Amen. He's in total control. He has the past, the present, and the future all in his hands at one time. Amen. There is no history outside of his control, even current history. You may think that current history is way out of whack, but Christ himself is in control right now. Amen. And why do we think like this has just happened in America? Chaos has happened ever since the Garden of Eden, and they rejected the voice of God. And And what God has to constantly do to his people is listen. Everybody doing what we did last week. Everybody say, do this with your mouth so you don't get nobody sick. Everybody say, listen. Remember previous verses, it says, blessed is he who reads it, right? Who hears it and what? Keeps it. And what he's trying to do is get our minds on the grace and on the greatness of Christ. You're not in control of history, church. No matter how much control you want of history, Christ will always have total control of history. And that should cause us to worship him even in the chaos. And how many of you had free worship this week? Man, you're just worshiping Christ. If you have it, it's probably because you're so focused on the chaos that you can't focus on the greatness of Christ, who has control of history. And he's got to repeat himself. That's funny, right? If you wonder why pastors repeat themselves, it's because Christ does. Amen? Some of y'all got that right. Look at verse 8, the end of it. The beginning and the end, right? He started creation, and he's going to finish creation. Right. Amen. In the beginning, who created? God. He's pointing you back to Genesis chapters 1 and 2. Amen. He started history, and he will finish history. Not you. Hey, y'all listen. Not America. Not China. Not Iraq. Christ Jesus started history, and he's going to finish history. And that's what got the early Christians killed. I don't think none of you can kill me right now, but if you did, I'm going home anyways. Amen? He's in control. He existed before any powerful nation on this planet. Where's Rome at, by the way? They still exist? So the question is, church, are we going to worship this king even if we didn't have our existence as a nation? That's where he wants your heart, by the way. Now, I'm not anti-American. Please don't go and tweet about me or make statuses about me. I'm thankful for the men and women that have died for our country. But brothers and sisters, as a pastor and as someone that studies the scriptures, Christ is more concerned about your love for him more than your love for America.
That's right.
And again, this is the same message that got Christ murdered in the disciples. So he repeats himself. Look what he says at the end of verse 8. He gives Christ this title or this name, or he makes this claim about Christ. Look what he says at the end. Who he is, and who was, and who is to what? Come. And he ends it by saying, the Almighty. Amen. So the title or claim or Almighty is mentioned about 10 times in the New Testament. Everybody do like this. 10. Everybody say 10. None of those times are in Revelation. So he mentions the title Almighty in the whole New Testament. None of those times are just in the book of Revelation. The title means that Christ has perfect, absolute authority, control, and power over his world. Worship him. Amen? Now, Pastor Steve, should we pray for everything to get back going? Yeah. Pray that the days are ahead of us are better than they are behind us. But y'all listen, your prayer needs to be most likely, God, make your greatness known to this nation and to all nations, because that's what Christ prayed.
Yes.
Right? If the nation of America is going to be great, it needs to be great because Christ is great, and it helps us to get the gospel to this community and to the world.
Right.
Amen? So church, are we really focused on the grace and on the greatness of Christ? Amen? He's in total, complete control this morning. But are you like me? You need him to daily remind you of that. Everybody say daily.
Daily.
Because if y'all think, Pastor Steve, this is something I can read and just get it deep within my heart and never have to come back to it, you're thinking wrongly this morning. Every single day, Pastor Steve has to get his head in the Word of God and say, you know what? In the midst of all the chaos, in the midst of all the sin, in the midst of all the brokenness, Christ is great, and his grace has filled my soul.
Amen.
Word?
Amen. It's something that we do daily. Don't you think that the disciples and the apostles, they struggled? Yeah. But aren't you glad the gentleness of the Holy Spirit would keep pushing them back to the greatness and to the grace of God? I mean, you just think about it. They're getting locked up in the book of Acts, killed in the book of Acts, and they continue to get their minds on the grace and on the greatness of Christ. Because there's something that God does supernaturally whenever we get our minds on His grace and on His greatness in the midst of the chaos. Praise God. And so, let me just encourage you. Right? Everybody say encourage.
Encourage.
Based on the verses we read, Christ is in control. Amen? Christ is sovereign. I don't know about you, the Lord has been proving this decade after decade, century after century. God has to continually to remind His people, I am in control. Yeah. Amen? Yeah. Abraham, I'm in control, man. I know you're at the end of your life, and you're counting on me to give you and Rachel a baby. And in their latter years, the Lord stays faithful and gives them a baby. Amen? To them, the world seems out of control. He says, I'm in control. And then just think about the people in Israel, right? They're in slavery for how many years? 400 years. They think, man, there's no hope. They're crying out to God yearly for 400 years. And guess who shows up on the scenes? Not Moses, God through Moses. Praise God. Amen? He rescues them from slavery. He splits the Red Sea open. And guess what? Yahweh is in control. Right? You go study the book of Judges. The people are in this cycle, right? They're living for God. They rebel against God. They cry out to God. They start living for God. And guess who keeps showing up constantly for rebellious people? The Lord.
Amen?
What He's trying to show us in the Old Testament and New Testament, I'm in control of this world that is full of brokenness and sin and pain.
You open it up and get in it, man, it'll be so worth it. Because He calms our souls down like no other.
Amen? Amen? Some of us just need to get in here. Get off the media. Get off social media. And get in, thus says the Lord. You said that last week. I know I did. Did it work? Only the Lord knows it, some people. Everybody say, the Lord,
is in control.
Let's worship. Let's sing a song. Hey, everybody, let's just close your eyes. This is something new I've been doing. Let's reach our hands to the heavens. I'm not looking around. And as dawn or whoever's going to play, just softly play for us right now. By the way, the Lord loves music. You see it throughout the scriptures. Say, Lord, help us. Father, help us to get our minds on You. God, the chaos isn't going to end. Things may get better, but chaos will always exist. And Father, we need You to just help us to get our minds on You this morning. Refresh us, restart us, Lord. We need it daily. Things can happen quickly in a week. Things can happen quickly in even an hour. And we just need Your Holy Spirit to give us strength to focus on You.